Okay. Cool. Yeah, it's recording. Today I'm presenting kind of a follow-up on the things I presented, right before the holidays. So broadly, I mean, this is the whole reinterpretation of grid cells as implementing a sort of sensory basis that is still map-like, but it's like a sensory basis. In today's extension to it, I'm going to show you a model using grid cells of a sort that I think might influence the way you think about entorhinal cortex. And I think you're going to be able to kind of introspect using this model. You're going to be able to imagine yourself using this algorithm, and it's going to provide like some nice insight, and I think nice insight into explaining why grid cells distort and other things like that. This is going to revolve around. Here, I'll just present my whole screen. This is going to revolve around this email that I sent all the people here. So I'll walk through the email. That's how I'll organize this. Summary. A few weeks ago, I presented a way of thinking about grid cells. Rather than grid cells being primarily concerned with learning maps of specific environments, grid cells learn a sensory basis for representing arbitrary environments. But it's a special kind of basis that enables prediction. And I'll bring up a slide from there. This was one of the slides I presented there, that I took the conventional view of grid cells as a map, as learning maps of environments, and kind of the idea of a basis where you think of like Gabor filters and how inputs determine what gets activated, and found a way to fuse them, found a way to give you something that gives you both of those properties. And when you have something like this, it kind of changes your emphasis from learning and recognizing environments to being able to represent arbitrary environments, but representing them in a nice way where you can still predict what representations are gonna be when you land somewhere else. Another way of saying this that that Jeff, I know, found instructive was that if you enter a room from two different places, a novel environment, then you walk from one place to the other, either way you're gonna, end up with the same representation. There's no random selection. The grid cell representation is based on what you sense, but it has this property of path integration.
One thing that occurred to me while I was reading your write-up, Marcus, and it's sort of, and maybe this is really stupid, I don't know. So prepare yourself. But it seems like, there's these two sort of big camps in the world of entorhinal cortex and hippocampal complex. You got the people who favor grid cells and the people who favor place cells, And and so, but obviously they interact, and so this sort of reminds me of the sort of place cell view of the world. Like, oh, you're using sensory input to learn maps of environments, and the grid cells are there just to assist, And if you look coming from the grid cell point of view, you say, no, grid cells are the basis of everything, and then we just assign sensory data to the locations. Is this consistent with the idea that you might be describing more what's going on in the grids in the place cell world? It's because that's all sensory driven, and that place cells are really sort of defining the environments, which is sensory inputs defining the environments, and then the grid cells there are to assist. I mean, this idea that you just described, you enter the room from two different directions, you end up with the same grid mapping, is a very powerful idea, but it sort of strikes me as like, oh, that's how I would ideally want a place cell view of the world to behave. Does that make sense? Is that at all?
So I think I'm kind of addressing that debate and making it fizzle away by making it where grid cells actually have that property, but grid cells are also map-like.
But why would you say grid cells are the problem? Couldn't you just say that? Couldn't you just say sort of extend the grid cell network to include place cells and say, oh, this network has that property? I mean, why does it have to all be just in the grid cells themselves? Because clearly grid cells themselves are, as they're classically defined, are just really driven by motor behavior and nothing about sensory input. And so you're extending them.
The definition is lacking. It doesn't explain a lot of things about them.
I know. So I'm just trying to make, I'm trying to I'm trying to see if I could say that what you've come up with is a better way of thinking about grid cells that's really sensory driven, but that's consistent with what's going on with place cells interacting with grid cells. I mean, the question is, could what you be describing is what actually is going on in the entorhinal cortex if I include place cells? It's another way of putting that.
Yeah, I mean, in my mental model, place cells will be part of how this basis gets learned, or how you determine which grid cells should be active. Place cells play into that circuit, and those might be where the actual learning of the basis is occurring.
So I'll take that as a yes then. Here's another way of summarizing what you presented, and I may be wrong, but another way of saying, hey, we have this idea of how place cells and grid cells work. And the idea up to now has been that when you enter a new environment, you randomly anchor your grid cells. And you're saying, no, you don't randomly anchor your grid cells. You even when you're in a novel environment, you anchor your grid cells based on sensory input. And so I could just say it's the same thing that everyone's been talking about between grid cells and place cells, but with this new twist that you don't randomly anchor grid cells in a new environment. You're going to pick them judiciously. Would that be a reasonable summary of this?
Yeah, that's a good angle on that. Yeah.
Okay. Because then it fits more my mental model of what the world is, but just makes it better. Okay. All right. I'm gonna go with that for now. Okay. Okay. That's good.
Okay. So to show one more slide from this. So one thing I am changing here, I'm keeping number one here, but number two here, the objective where I was trying to use time. The reason I used time and wanting the grid cells to update linearly over time, my motivation for that was that it could explain grid cell distortions. But now I have a different explanation for that. So my next slide said, like, the obvious alternate version of this is one that uses movement to update grid cells, and that the same movement applied multiple times is going to cause the same update to the grid cells. But my criticism of this was always that it wouldn't explain grid cell distortions in parentheses. And a lot of people are really uncomfortable with calling grid cells metric because of the grid cell distortions. It makes people nervous, like maybe we're getting something wrong about it. So what I'm presenting today is my realization that I've had since the last presentation that, in fact, this model can explain grid cell distortions. In fact, you would expect it when you use this sensory basis viewpoint of grid cells, that you will expect something like this. And today, so what I'm about to do is I'm going to show you a model of grid cells that is fairly simple. You'll be able to play it out in your head and simulate it in your head, and see that it in fact will have distortions, and it will have other properties that are seen empirically with grid cells. So there were a set of exciting realizations happened here. So in those realizations, I'm going to give is like a set of bullet points in this email. But first I'm going to present the model. So this first bullet point was just where I'm embracing the metric view or the path integration view rather than that time view. But just to say, I might bring the time view back to talk about representing other variables and making grid cells do other things, but putting that aside completely for now. So I won't even read the rest of this paragraph. I'm going to come back to these bullet points where I talk about all the various parts of grid cells that just kind of fall into place when you adopt this view. I'm going to go ahead and give you the model, then come back up and talk about these. And so I'm going to describe this in terms of a figure. I'll show you one more slide from the previous presentation just to bring back the visual language. In the simulation I ran, I didn't run any new simulation, but the one I presented before, it was a rat wandering around an environment. Its input was these object vector cells, which kind of denote where, objects or boundaries are relative to the animal, but in an external reference frame. And what the network wanted to do was represent the input and do a good job of representing the input. For example, via reconstruction error, but there are other ways. But I'm changing the second part of this objective, where it's no longer using time, it's using, movement updates should cause the same update. And so the visual language I used here was you have an agent moving, and I called this foliage, And the reason I'm showing this part is to show what I changed now. So previously, what was being passed into the network, the input the grid cells were receiving, was basically the surroundings of the animal, so those are object vector cells. You can also just think of it as an image, like of a camera that's floating above the animal. But of course it's in the reference frame of the room. It's rotated with the room. What I'm changing now is I'm making it more of an attentional system. Rather than using the surroundings of the animal, the agent is going to attend to different locations in the room, and it's going to reuse those same object vector cells, except it's going to use them relative to the attended location. So I'm going to use an attentional system, and I'm going to use displacements or displacement cells. And so I'm going to do the entire same system from before, but from afar now you're going to reconstruct.
Are you doing a displacement from the agent's reference frame or displacement?
Yeah. Yes. The next figure shows this. I'll read, after I show this figure, I'll scroll up and just read through the text a little bit, but yes, I'm going to use the displacement from the space around the agent to the attended area of space. And that is going to play into that. This it's an important part. So I'll go ahead and read these two short paragraphs because they're short and just making sure I cover everything. So an agent uses attention to observe a set of points in the environment. And at each point, the agent gets an input image. So this image can be object vector cells, boundary vector cells, but they're relative to the attended location. They're not relative to the agent. You don't have to have object vector cells extending out into infinity. You can reuse the same set relative to the attended location. This is where I talk about introspections might actually work nicely with this model as you attend to places around the room. So what the agent wants to do as it attends to these various locations in the room is the agent wants to represent its self location, its grid cell representation for where it is, in a way that enables reconstruction of all of these. And the trick here is, you might be able to anticipate it because I already mentioned displacement cells. The trick here is the agent uses the spatial displacement from—
Can I just reset that sentence again?
Yeah.
You're saying the representation of my location, which I normally think of as, how am I anchoring my grid cells? I'm not sure if that's still what it means here. But that representation actually tells you what those things are at those locations out there. Is that what there seems to be a numerical problem with that. The number of, well, maybe not, I don't know. The number of possible combinations of things that I might see when I attend to them is quite large, right? It's really, really big. And so my possible encoding of my locations has to accommodate that. I guess it could. Am I thinking about that correct? It's like,
well, yeah, but part of that's going to be solved by attending to certain distinctive parts in the room.
So limiting the number of things I attend to would reduce the dimensionality problem.
Yes.
Right? Okay.
That is going to play into this.
All right. It seems too magical. I still don't understand how it works, but it seems magical that you could do this, and that even if you did it from different directions, the two entries to the room would still work. So it's pretty amazing if it worked. I just still don't understand it, but okay, I'm sorry to keep interrupting.
So just to fill in the blanks of the missing piece I haven't said yet, the agent uses the agent combines its grid cells representing its self location with the displacement. It's just a standard grid cell displacement to obtain the grid cell representation for the attended location. So the same set of cells that it used for object vector cells relative to itself, if you displace the grid cell representation to a new location, it can now be used the same way over there. It can now be used to reconstruct what object vector cells you would expect relative to this point.
Hmm.
And so soon I'll talk about this network diagram. I'll even bring it in view as I read. The agent then uses the attended location's grid cell representation to reconstruct the input. And then they do error correction. They adjust the representation as needed to better reconstruct the actual input image. So it predicts what it's going to sense, gets the actual input, improves the grid cell representation at the attended location. And then that, you know, that propagates back, not back propagation, but like it propagates back, like the displacement is then removed and it's used to improve the self location. So through a series of attention shifts, the agent chooses a single self location grid cell representation that best reconstructs the input images at each of the attended locations. This diagram, you could have written down this diagram from the description above, but this is just makes it all explicit. This self-location, this is standard grid cells. This is the location of the animal in an external reference frame. As the animal attends to locations, what's happening is the attention system is setting this displacement. It's setting the displacement of the attended location from the self-location. That is being combined with the self-location to get the grid cell representation of the attended location. These very well might be one population, or they could be two separate populations. This is a common theme whenever we talk about adding displacements to grid cells. It could always be two populations, or it could be one that's oscillating or something.
Yeah.
And then this is being used to reconstruct the object vector cells. And of course, when I say object vector cells here, it's standing in for a whole suite of cell types. It could be landmark vector, it could be boundary vector, it could be something other things that have not yet been defined that are sort of a high level description of the input image. It could be a lot of things. So the attentional system is actually playing a role in both parts of these, as you might notice. The displacement is being set by the attention system, or vice versa. You could say the displacement is setting the attention system. But then it's also influencing what image comes in to the system. This circuit is quite, you know, simple if you just like stare at it for a little while. With this in mind, I mean, this is a system that you move your area of attention around the room, and you do that repeatedly, moving to a certain set of locations, probably using heuristics based on what's, you know, the most distinctive, what stands out, what's useful to pay attention to. And using that, you build up your grid cell representation that enables you to reconstruct all of those.
You show some of those grid cells as being gray. Does that mean they're being modified? What does that mean?
It means they're different magnitudes.
Okay. I forgot. That was something you added before,
yeah, that was,
right?
Yeah. Part of the previous presentation.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah. So that helps them really implement a basis, basically.
So there's two things that are happening here. One is you're deciding how to anchor the grid cell modules, and then the other is what their activation level is. Is that correct?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah. And the firing rate, of course, corresponds to, you know, actual results seen where in different fields of grid cells firing rate will be different. And of course, there's like the missed fields result that also kind of fits into this.
You know, sometimes when I think about a firing rate, you usually think about, okay, there's some graded response to something, like there's a lot of this or a little of this or something like that. I'm trying to understand what would that mean here? Like, okay, well, this grid cell is firing half the rate of this grid cell. Well, what does that mean? Besides maybe mathematically working out right, does it have some intuitive meaning to that? It's like, well, I'm not certain about this part or... I don't know what that means. Do you have any sense for that? How would I interpret that?
Well, in what I presented before, using a very simplistic basis for reconstruction, I did something that was quite Fourier-like, where it was actually looking for frequencies to reconstruct a picture of the object vector cells. And so it was actually the presence of a certain frequency. It was whether the object vector cells happen to be aligned in a way that almost whether they land in a certain Gabor filter, almost as if there are boundaries in the room.
But these are not object, these are grid cells. These are not object vector cells. These are just grid cells.
These are grid cells, right? But they're gonna, Right.
So it's not like when I have a gray cell there, I'm saying, oh, it's what's the frequency of this? Or, you know, it's more like that represents some sort of indication of location. And it's not, I guess I'm just not thinking about it the way
you're. It's a question of whether this input image contains some kind of frequency that matches up with that grid cell module.
Okay, so it's like I have my grid cell modules are anchored properly, but then I change the activity rates of them to reflect, well, somehow, in a way, I still understand. They reflect what's out there, what I'm seeing. Yeah. Okay, I'll just have to put it aside.
Yeah, they're almost like, in the spatial pooler, they're almost like mini columns where they have a certain filter that they're applying to the surroundings. And the phase is like translating that filter and saying where it's most active, if that helps.
Maybe I have to think about it more. We're not gonna have time for me to get it.
So now I'm going to go up and talk about the properties of grid cells that will just naturally happen in this system. So the big exciting realization, I mean, first I put this here. Recently, I realized that the objective, the time objective I used before, isn't actually necessary to explain grid cell distortions. What I'm claiming to you now is that what I just presented is absolutely going to have grid cell distortions. So this first sentence is a little confusing because I'm trying to introduce it as we go. So here, I'll jump to here. The grid cells are going to prioritize reconstructing nearby object vector cells or boundary vector cells. And because it's going to prioritize nearby objects and boundaries, there will naturally be distortions. To make sense of this, I should read the next sentence. This is guaranteed to happen simply because there is more uncertainty about faraway objects and faraway boundaries. So the reconstruction of these will be less strict. So what I'm saying here is like, as you look around the room, as you put your attention at different locations in the room, further away locations are gonna have more uncertainty in the displacement vector and how far away the thing is that you're attending to. And it's also going to have more uncertainty in the actual visual input itself. And so if you have reconstruction error there, if your grid cell representation is kind of mediocre at reconstructing what's out there, you might not even know it, because there's so much uncertainty there that it's just not going to be prioritized by the representation. The representation wants to represent what's nearby because that's where it has the most accurate data. So it is the case that if you now walk across the room to that thing you were attending to and it's now close to you, that reconstruction error is now apparent and you're gonna correct for it. And when you correct for it, that's gonna translate to updating your grid cells. You're gonna change which phase is active, or you're gonna change their magnitude.
The magnitude is something that changing the phase which is active would be sort of contrary to experimental results that people have reported, right? I've never heard of anyone saying that.
That is what a distortion is.
I see. But the distortion is a linear change. It's not like I just jumped to some random new point, right? So are you saying that, so it's not like I just re-anchor. It's more like I'll stretch them or something like that.
The module is going to activate a different cell that's adjacent to its-
Adjacent one.
Yeah.
Got it. It wouldn't be just a random re-anchoring. It's a-
Right.
An adjacent one. Okay, got it, yeah.
Right. And so, I went with the explanation that assumes the least. I based this on uncertainty. Uncertainty alone is going to explain explain distortions if you use this basis point of view. But it's quite reasonable to go further and say at different locations the animal's going to attend to different landmarks or objects. Or at least give more emphasis to certain ones. It will attend to nearby ones more anyway, or anyway, the distribution of which landmarks are, weighted, which ones receive the most importance, is going to change anyway. So that you'll especially expect this to happen. But I don't depend on this, though it seems quite likely that you would attend to different objects at different locations in the room. I basically fitted into there. This also explains why magnitudes would be different in different firing fields. Because as you move, it's the same thing as distortions. They're two sides of the same coin. It's the magnitudes and the phases being updated to properly reconstruct the things that are near you, because that's where you have the most up-to-date data or most accurate data. The another thing I was excited about, so this is a thing I intentionally didn't bring up before in my and the other big presentation, because I knew it was the weakness in what I was presenting. A classic thing about grid cells that makes people think about them as learning a map is that if you put an animal in a familiar environment, let them become very acquainted with it, take them out, compress the environment, push the walls closer together along one axis, put the animal back in, it compresses the grid. The grid is now compressed along one dimension. It's kind of preserved relative to the walls. And that is not something you'd expect if grid cells were just doing a basis, or at least that's what I thought. You would expect it to just always treat it as a novel environment, and its past experience wouldn't make much difference. But now, as I phrase it here, now I'm expanding this basis theory to swallow that learned environments theory. Grid cells don't learn environments, just as the spatial pooler doesn't learn objects. So instead, as an animal spends a lot of time in a single environment, the basis is being modified to better represent the environment and environments similar to it. This is a little bit like, I'm going to keep using our models. It's a little bit like the spatial pooler, how you might expect if an animal starts to see a lot of the same input pattern again and again and again, eventually as many columns are going to start representing features that are more closely resembling that environment. Like a specific arrangement of walls and landmarks and stuff is going to be represented by a given mini column because the animal experiences that room so many times, it begins to become useful to treat something that is specific to that room or almost specific to that room as a basis element. So I think the learned environments thing is actually here. It is really just that the basis is being updated to the statistics the animal is encountering. And it just so happens that a lot of the statistics the animal is encountering is this room.
And when you we're going to run out of time, I'm afraid, but one of the things that seems to be missing from this is that, our current thinking about when you learn a room, there's a lot of things in the room you might learn. And so the idea is that you would assign these things at different displacements or locations in the room. But when you're pairing sensory observations with grid cell locations, you have a very, very a large ability to make a detailed model of the room. If I'm trying to encode the entire room just in the grid cell activation, it seems like it's very limiting in that regard. It's like I won't be able to get the details that I might know about a particular room. There's just too many details, right? It's always going to be based on sort of, if I think about my dining room, I know it's all these details, all these little things are all over the place. It's hard to imagine that's just encoded in the grid cell encoding itself, as opposed to pairing grid cells with spatial related data. It seems like you're abandoning the separate representation of spatial related data here. You're folding it into the grid cells themselves. Am I missing that? I get that wrong, or?
This is a way of representing novel environments. So how it is the arrangement of silverware in your drawers or something like that, and have that memorized. I'm not explaining that right here. I'm not presenting a neural mechanism for that.
Okay. It seems like you're arguing that you're learning an environment by modifying the grid cells, as opposed to pairing sensory observation with grid cell locations. And I don't think you need to abandon the latter part to have the former part. So I'm just pointing out, I don't think you can encode everything in a room purely in the grid cell encodings. I think you could use the basic features of the room, which I think is your main hypothesis here, the basic features of the room, some subset of basic structure to figure out how you can represent that both in the anchoring and the activity of grid cells. But then I still might need to pair specific locations with detailed knowledge about, oh, where are these specific things located, and lots of them, dozens and dozens of things that might be in this reference frame.
Yeah.
Is that, so I just don't want to go too far here. If you, you know, I don't want to think that we can, I don't think you can get to everything just in the grid cell.
No, for sure. Definitely.
Okay. I just was just.
In some sense here, the learning is almost not essential to what I'm doing here. I'm not talking about learning rooms. I'm talking.
I thought you did there. You say
this is where I address what's happening when we see grid cells changing when they once an environment has been learned.
So
I'm explaining that can all be described in the context of a basis being updated.
Okay.
No, everything you're saying is right. I'm not solving that problem right here.
Okay. All right. So we don't have to throw away the basic idea of an environment is defined by a set of displacements of sub-objects relative to each other or to the environment. But you're getting partially the way there with the grid cells. You're saying grid cells on their own can essentially make, they encode basic structure of this environment, not all the details, but basic structure based on some large scale observations, which I think is very cool. But that's, I'm saying this just to make you to say, no, Jeff, you got it wrong.
No, that's right.
Okay.
I'd say that this is all compatible with, one of the last things I say in this email is like, how is this useful to AI? And one possibility is that this is creating unique representations from including lots of context from the room around you that you could then treat as a fingerprint or as a memory location. You could then associate it with things. You can now turn this into a memory system.
Yeah.
So I'm totally open to that. But
yeah.
But I'm providing something useful without doing that first.
Yeah. Okay.
So I'll try to just go through each of these quite efficiently.
I've been asking too many questions.
No, you're good. What I want to get across here is a set of grid cell properties, a set of empirical results that have confused me and made me feel weird about my understanding of grid cells, just all fell into place once this all came together. So another thing that really follows from the previous points, from learned environments and from distortions and everything, was merged environments. You train a rat on two different environments, get it so it recognizes them, quote unquote recognizes them, and then remove the barrier between them, and the rat realizes that now it's in one environment that is the two merged. The map is in a sense fused smoothly. If the rat's on one side of the room, it's almost as if the grid cell response properties on either end of the room are almost unaffected. In the middle, it's kind of like a hybrid. The two are like mixed.
This is another flavor of the distortion argument, right? This is like, if I'm far into the room, I'll have one set of anchorings, and if I'm the other end of the room, I'll have different set of anchorings, and somewhere in the middle, they have to get distorted to represent each other or meet each other. Is that correct?
Yes. So it's going to kind of balance being able to reconstruct either side of the room. Yeah. And the map viewpoint, the pure map viewpoint probably would have told you that it discreetly hops between the two. At some point, it's confused and discreetly hops. And so I think the basis viewpoint, actually, this all works quite nicely with it because it can represent either side of the room quite well. However, it's going to prioritize the nearby part, not the far away part. And so it all just kind of will fall in line and work like that.
There have been experiments where the rat goes between two rooms through a little narrow doorway. And the argument has been when the rat does that, the cells re-anchor. But what you would be arguing here is that they're merging very rapidly. So it's like, you know, it's not necessarily a remapping. It's just like there's an area where there's a lot of commonality to be viewed, and so they might get remapped quickly, or distorted quickly. It's a different view. It's like, oh, new space, remap randomly. No, it's like, no, you're gonna base your mapping on the sensory data. But once you pass through the threshold, all your sensory data is different. Therefore, it's a slightly different way. Again, getting away from the idea that we're re-anchoring randomly. You're not. You have a new set of visual clues, and therefore everything has to quickly change.
Yeah. Almost the last thing. By the way, when I talked about attention updating grid cells, I wasn't just making that up. That's a thing that is seen in primates, both humans and non-human primates. And so grid cells following your attention is a thing that we've sort of maybe had explanations for in the past, but this really incorporates it as being just part of the system. And this would suggest that maybe even rats do this to some extent. It's just, I mean,
did we read papers on this? I don't remember this thing.
Yes, but yeah, I should insert a little bit more information. This has been seen with humans and non-human primates when they're looking at a screen and isocoting around the screen.
Okay, I guess I would love to read it if you could later remember to send a paper about that. I don't remember this. It sounds interesting.
Yeah, and other disclaimer, in humans it was fMRI, but in monkeys it was a single unit recordings. Okay. And I've talked to people who work on this, and they suspect that as you look around a room, it's going to occur as well, not just looking at a screen, but that remains to be seen. It's a really hard experiment to run, especially with fMRI. It's much easier to run the fMRI one on a screen that's in front of you. But that is a real phenomenon, and I'm taking advantage of it and suggesting that maybe even rats have it too. But how would you test for that? It's hard to test for that in something that doesn't have so much of a, you know, head fixed, so much of a visual system. I'll just say that this gives you a point of view on, like, when you're out hiking, walking through the wilderness, you see landmarks, what the heck are your good cells doing? This really gives you a clear point of view on what might be happening as you do that. It's more of like a continuous, gradual re-anchoring or remapping of grid cells based on the set of landmarks that you tend to attend to when you're at that location.
So we're going to run out of time here, but I have one burning question I want to ask you. The reason we like metric grid cells is that it allows us to compute what behavior we need to achieve a goal. If I want to get from point A to point B, I can just compute the distances in each grid cell module, and especially under the certain conditions we're working with right now. But that's one of the main things it allows you to do. Now, if grid cells are no longer metric in the sense of like linear metric, how do I do that? I mean, I'm in the wilderness. I still have an idea what direction I should go to get back to my car, right? It seems like by having the grid cell be distorted, I'm not saying they are distorted, we know this, but how is it that I then can compute movements or compute distances?
It's a totally valid question. Because this is using the metric properties for lots of things, but locally,
it's not going to work globally.
Right, locally, and also for reconstructing what's far away. But no, you're totally right. If you know your current location and you have a remembered location that's somewhere else, and you want to know how to get back to that remembered location, if grid cells are distorted, and more specifically, if the individual modules distort independent of each other, the whole mechanism breaks down. You can't read out.
I was hoping you were going to give me a nice answer to this.
No, you can't read out a displacement anymore. If you have distortions and the distortions are independent of each other, you can't read out displacements anymore. You're now going to get something that can't be read out as a displacement.
But that
criticism goes to, like, you know, empirical results, not just to this model.
I know, but I'm it seems to be an important thing to be able to do, and that's why one of the reasons we like linear metric grid cells. Because it's an explanation for how we might go about that. It's also an explanation how we might build a model of something that, you know, a detailed model of something that's, I don't know, that I can visualize in any direction and know how far things away. I don't know. So now it throws us back into like, shit, I don't know how to get, you know.
We've never fully liked that explanation though, because you have to have this huge readout table of being able to read.
Well, I actually don't think I've moved to the point where the only grid cells that matter are the ones that where I'm not repeating within the environment that I'm modeling. So if I restrict my grid cell modules to the ones that are large enough, the phases are separated enough, then I'm not dealing with the repetitive grid cell part, and I don't have to have a lookup table. I can literally just say for each, let's say I had a bunch of 1D grid cell modules, I can say each one, what cell, how far away I am to the next cell. So that's how I was getting around that problem. Okay, well, we'll have to leave that as an unsettled question.
It's about lunchtime. So I think this is our logical ending point.
Yeah. I'm sorry, I dominated the conversation here, but hope I didn't discourage other people from jumping in.
Okay, I think we're done.
All right.